Hey guys, welcome back. We got back on time. That's new. You have a loud mic.
Oh yeah, it was extremely loud, but it's fixed
Sorry,
now.
Angelo.
It's okay. So
After you.
sorry. We are back with the Indie Games Showcase. We got another 10 games.
We have another 10.
10 game, 10 games prepped.
If not more. Let's go for it.
So the first game we have coming up, Treasure Adventure World, by Robit Studios.
Yep.
Let's just dive right into the trailer.
Got it. Pull up the trailer, boss.
I'm Stephen Orlando, creator of Treasure Adventure World. For the past year, my team and I have been hard at work on our new game, and we appreciate you taking the time to watch this trailer. As you just saw, we're not just remaking Treasure Adventure game, but we're rehauling it from the ground up. We're remixing most of the puzzles and adding new levels, enemies, and bosses. Some of these changes I wanted to include in the original game, but we also have a lot of new fresh ideas. As I'm sure you're aware, making quality video games takes time, talent, and money. As independent developers, we've been smart about keeping our costs low, but in order for the team to continue developing Treasure Adventure World full-time, we need to raise funds. Pre-orders and social funding have become popular, and we're not ones to shy away from this trend. That's why we're reaching out to you, the gamers, fans, and fellow artists, to help us continue developing Treasure Adventure World. There's a lot in it for you, too. We have a number of pre-order rewards. You can get your name in the credits, access to a private blog with tons of concept art, sketches, animations, and music demos. We're also giving out a limited number of sketches used in development of Tag and Treasure Venture World. Each one will be personally signed by me. And our most exciting reward lets you become immortalized as the interactive animated NPC in the game. We also have exciting ideas for stretch goals. If we can reach certain funding targets, we'll be able to add even more content. Our first goal is set at a modest $50,000. Once we reach that goal, we're going to include a retro costume, where you can play the game as an updated version of the kid from the original game, bald head and all. At this level, our musician Robert Ellis has also promised a full-length remix soundtrack from the original game, and we're going to give you the option of playing with either the original or the remix soundtrack. And that's just the beginning. We have 5 additional stretch goals that will be unlocked once you raise enough money. Thanks again for taking the time to watch this. We hope you'll join us in our effort to create a fun, exciting, and beautiful gaming experience. If you're interested in pre-ordering, visit our website at treasureadventureworld.com. From everybody at Robit Studios, thank you.
So,
wow,
Treasure Adventure World. So this is actually my first chance to look at the game itself. I didn't see the original.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm immediately attracted to the style of, you know, the Wind Waker-esque adventure theme of, you know, you're sailing around in your little sailboat.
Yep.
There's like a different obstacle, a different little adventure on mini puzzle in every island.
Yeah. I was impressed by the huge variety of puzzles going on.
Yeah. I liked all the RPG elements, mm-hmm. like, you know, the little kind of Legend of Zelda upgrades and like the Metroid style upgrades to your hook. You can mm-hmm. become a boomerang hook or a fireball hook.
Yep.
There's definitely a lot of cool bosses. It's kind of like a Super Metroid-esque.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, platformer style for, like, a lot of the combat.
All about very attractive. Exploring just a wide variety of spaces mm-hmm. and all of the different things that go along with that. It was very impressive. And I love how Robot Studios has been developing the same style of game, mm-hmm. but exploring it in different ways over a long period of time. To where they have like a working prototype almost now in Treasure Adventure, the original.
Right.
That has now evolved into this idea of Treasure Adventure World. And I think that that's really cool and amazing yeah. how they've put this together. The trailer is so impressive. And all of the different like modes that you could play within,
mm-hmm.
I was super impressed by. Like sometimes you're floating up inside of bubbles. Other times you are a submariner.
Yeah, what got me the most is when he was sailing on the boat and then just jumped off with the helmet on.
I'm
and
out.
Then
See
started
guys.
Delving. And I was like, is the entire ocean an explorable environment?
Yeah.
Because that would just be super, that would be really cool.
Yeah.
So Treasure Adventure World brought to us by Robot Studios. Definitely an impressive title.
One other thing was that the theme of the pacing and the overall flow of the game just seemed so relaxed.
Yeah, it was very relaxed. Yeah, very,
it wasn't like
calming.
It wasn't a high anxiety kind of pressured game where
it was a very upbeat,
you have
like
a lot of
treasure adventure. You know, mm-hmm. you're a fun loving pirate out to get some gold.
I don't even know if there was UI for health. I know that you took damage because when you got hit by lava, it was like -1 off of your body. But I don't know if there's necessarily a visible health thing.
It may not have been enabled in the trailer footage.
Totally true. But that kind of like adds to that. Like it, mm-hmm. it seems relaxed and it seems you're not running super fast, but you're not running super slow. You have just a very nice working gait.
Brisk
yeah.
walk.
Yeah. That's my pacing ad.
So let's get on to the next title.
In the wrong keys. There we go. This is a video for a game called Mail Demon. Oh, let's get it over to that side first.
So if we could switch. Thank you.
Thank you. So that's Mail Demon. That's the trailer that we have for Mail Demon.
Right. It was a short, kind of like an engine teaser, if anything else.
Yeah,
it would be best described as like an engine teaser. And we don't have a whole lot of other information on the game, but mm-hmm. You might be able to access more information. Can you tell us where we might be able to access more information?
That was what we were given.
Okay. The name of the developer, by any chance?
That was what we were given.
All right. a sparse email, but
yes, yeah,
you probably find more information on Google. Mail Demon.
Hopefully,
Mail Demon.
With the A in it.
Yes,
that's probably even more
Daemon.
More complex search results.
And it is mail, as in a letter carrier.
That's true. That would make it easier. Yeah. Maybe not. I don't know. But yeah, shooting top-down kind of style.
He did have kind of like a mailman moniker. He's like in his blue work uniform and his little pixel gun.
Yeah.
All right, so on to the next title.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
I do that every time.
Star Crawlers.
Oh, we're trying to find an echo.
Oh, yes, I hear it. It might be playing from the PC.
Does the chat hear it as well? Or is that just in our heads? I figure since you haven't said anything, you might not hear the faint...
It's either from the computer.
We have so many audio sources going in and out of places that we're trying to find...
1, 2, 1, 2. Where yeah, it's from the monitor.
Oh, it came from the monitor of all things. All
right, that was done.
Oh, because we reset the monitors and flashed some stuff and knobs were turned and dials were touched. Yeah, James has just been on fire all day.
So let's get over to the browser for Star Crawlers.
Yes. Thank you guys for bearing with us. So this is the splash page for StarCrawlers.com. And it is a game that I believe has a trailer at the bottom of this. I'm pretty sure that's why I put this in here.
It's probably on the Kickstarter.
There you go. That's why I put this on here.
There you go.
And they won.
They won.
So obviously, they're usually when you get a Kickstarter, the trailers are the money makers. So
yeah.
I'm prepared to be impressed.
Hi, I'm Asa, and this is George.
And we're part of the team from Juggernaut Games, a small game studio in San Diego, California.
We've been working together for 3 years, the past 6 months of which we've been working on our first independent title, Star Crawlers.
Star Crawlers is an old-school dungeon crawler with a first-person perspective, sci-fi theme, and randomly generated levels. In Star Crawlers, you're going to build a team of mercenaries and recruit characters like hackers, psychers, and cyber ninjas.
Your team will take jobs to loot abandoned ships, unravel conspiracies, and raid corporate facilities.
When we first set out to make a first-person dungeon crawler game, we immediately went to traditional fantasy tropes, and we were like, oh, we're going to have orcs and goblins and ogres and things. And then Asa randomly did some sketches of a sci-fi robot environment, and we were like, oh, let's explore this further. This sounds really exciting. And once he started building out, like, oh, you can navigate like a spaceship wreck, and there's all kinds of robots populating it, we immediately knew that's where we wanted to take it.
I also love the first-person dungeon crawl genre. I think it's a genre that doesn't see a lot of games, and I don't really know too many of them that are sci-fi, and I think putting those two things together was really exciting, because we have a lot of this, the classic feel of going through there and finding these enemies, but at the same time, you know, all those enemies, instead of just goblins or orcs or anything like that, now we can make all kinds of weird robots, aliens, all kinds of crazy stuff.
Other than just robot enemies, working with a sci-fi theme allows us to explore the idea of a giant universe full of corporations that are vying for power. And the choices you make on the missions that they send you on are going to affect not only the outcome of the mission that you're actually on, but also your story overall.
We've worked hard on the pre-alpha, and now it's come to the point where we need funding to complete the game. We've come to Kickstarter because of the amazing support for games that big publishers have overlooked.
Another reason we were so excited to bring Star Crawlers to Kickstarter is to get the community involved in creating content for the game. We got all kinds of cool tiers that let you build NPCs in the game, design a mission, make an item, all kinds of fun stuff like that.
We're really excited about this project, and we hope you are too. Please consider supporting us and be part of Star Crawlers.
So,
that's Star Crawlers.
Star Crawlers.
So, first person dungeon crawler.
Now, it's been a while since I was really impressed by a first-person dungeon crawler, it's visually.
I agree. And that's kind of the first thing I saw was like, oh, we've got a A first-person dungeon crawler, which means the first thing that you're going to have to overcome is that you have a fixed camera angle in the classic style. And when you have a fixed camera angle, you don't have control over your scene as much as you usually do. So how do you impact that?
Now, I think you might actually have some point of control, actually, because there were times when I noticed where your character would stop, and then the camera angle would, like, very slightly adjust, like, up. Maybe
it did this, yeah, it did that short pan, but it was, like, a 60-degree pan. And
maybe if you, like, click on objects in the environment, your character will turn to look at them.
And might be something like that. Yeah, the bigger point, though, is that they had specific scenes set up that looked really cool. They almost kind of, I wasn't sure if they were framed to be boss fights, but, like, you would have the tile in front of you, and then the tile in front of that would be, like, your line of enemies. And they were all perfectly in frame, and it looked really, really good.
Yeah, the combat the combat frame looked really well done.
I was absolutely impressed by that.
Turn-based. I like the party system. If you notice, you got the party XP. Maybe you could be able to, like, swap out NPCs in your party. Maybe more of, like, a Mass Effect system where you have, like, constantly evolving dynamics with your party members. It definitely looks really cool.
And it was clear. The biggest thing, the UI was very clear on what was going on.
Yes. And lots of guns.
Lots of guns.
Lots of guns.
Guns, robots.
Sci-fi.
People with cyborg arms. Smoking cigar.
Yep.
That was my favorite. Fancy.
So if you guys are interested in more information, like it said in the trailer, you can find them on Kickstarter under the name Starcrawlers. They are already funded, but...
And this was funded only on March 13th, so only a couple months ago.
But they do have all the information present there, along with maybe some future content they're planning on working on. All right, so on to our next game.
One moment. I'm trying to remember who this was by, because that's the important part. This was not Real Folk Blues. Oh, this is Auto Repair. There we go.
Auto Repair. Oh, and Starcrawlers was by Juggernaut Games, folks.
Yes, yes. So now we can hit back. What we have for Auto Repair is just a GIF. And so I wish I could share the...
Well, you got wall jump.
...link with you, but...
You got wall jump.
No, the single GIF actually explains a lot about what is going on with the game Auto Repair that is so quick in development that you really just have Pompadour Han Solo wall jumping off of a little bit of dirt, a little bit of grass.
I get the feeling of some Tomb Raider themes.
Yeah.
The classic Tomb Raider themes.
That bounty hunter style Metroidvania kind of thing with the grid-like tunnels and stuff.
When I half expected him to destroy a portion of the wall and then to roll into it to pick up a missile upgrade, I was like, what?
Yeah, it's probably actually the pixel block just below the one he's shooting at.
Yep.
You know, I believe.
So how long this game's been in development?
I have no idea
it
other than this gift.
Recent.
So mysterious, right? But Auto Repair, we definitely know who it is by. Oh, that was the refresh button. But if we look at our schedule, Auto Repair is by Hunter Russell and Zach Bell.
So thanks for giving us insight onto your working title, folks.
And
can I make a short comment?
Absolutely.
I love that the name. I didn't realize that the name was actually a pun. Auto, not automobile, but auto is in the name.
Yeah. Yep. He is
and
repair.
I would like to share a short joke with the audience.
Oh, no.
That I received at Gen Con from Gary Gygax when I met him in person. And he informed us all that auto spelled inside out is toot. You're welcome, everybody.
Thanks, Gary Gygax.
Thank you for that. That guy. I see a statue of him every week because I delivered a Wizards of the Coast HQ.
Oh,
they have a statue of Gary Gygax. Yeah, it's pretty funny.
That's amazing.
So the next title we have for you guys is Talos. Or Telos?
Telos, yeah.
Telos.
And this is by Overpowered Games. Yeah. We have a trailer for this one.
So, let's get that trailer loaded up.
Or let's even
I'm
get
Justin,
it.
And this is the first development.
God. What have you done?
Get me out of here.
At the core of any good FPS is the movement system, so that's where I've started. You can tap for small hops, or you can hold and charge for giant leaps. There's also a grapple hook if you want even more maneuverability. I want it to be fun to move around the level even if there's nothing else going on, and I want to create something that rewards mastery. You play as a two-story tall mech with four legs. Instead of walking, it glides along the surface. The legs are procedurally animated with inverse kinematics. Another goal with the movement system is to make moving in outer space as fun as possible. And yep, that means zero gravity.
That was our first look into Telos.
Totally forgot to full screen until the very end, but I was just mystified. So we went from physics lesson to arcane kids in like 2.21 gigawatts.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, holy crap, the whiplash on that. It felt so good.
So immediately, super impressive, like spatial movement.
Yep.
Not only how it transfers like in a split second. From like no clip style zero G,
yeah.
To which also looks like you're like a grappling hook.
Yeah, you're like skating around attached to
stuff.
You're like
woo and like slingshot your way around stuff. That was cool.
Yep.
And also they have like the indoors mode, I guess.
Yeah.
Where like the gravity, the Gravotron kicks in.
Two different design spaces.
Yeah.
That interact with each other, and you can move in between flawlessly.
And he said it was a shooter. I think I'm pretty sure he said it was a shooter.
I wonder.
No, I don't know if we saw anything like that. It was a movement demo.
Yeah.
But I'm pretty sure it's like a multiplayer, like battle arena kind of like, you know.
The arms have to do that. They're there, right?
I assume, you know, you get like the Mega Man blaster cannon on one arm and you get the, you know, like the acid gun on the other one.
We were making jokes because like we saw the little weenie arms in
front.
They
look like cup holders.
And they're like, this is the best robot ever.
This is what the robot looks like.
The robot just arrow your drinks and then they like lasso away.
Yeah.
Away to get more drinks. that was like way too cool. Once we noticed that, like, oh, you're not supposed to look at the arms. You look past the arms, and you're just like, whoa!
Yeah,
and then like the music kicks
in. Yeah,
they're
in like this artificially like developed like space colony world.
Yeah,
with like the environment gates of made of lasers that get outside and stuff.
Just that momentum and the swing and all of it just looked like it felt so good.
They definitely put
it looked good, so it must feel good.
Yeah. They put tons of effort into the movement engine, and it shows. The way you interact with the environment is definitely really freeform.
Just impressed by the model detail on the robot itself. I don't know. They don't need to like have that level of detail, but the pistons on each arm was like, foom, foom.
Yeah, and then the way that the legs are like, they're terrain sensitive.
Yeah.
So like if they were on a surface, you know, inclination in the legs and stuff like that.
It's like, oh, come on, guys. That's way too cool.
I mean... A lot of people take that for granted in modern games, but when like Halo 3 first did that with like Master Chief standing on the steps, that was like revolutionary. So the fact that they as an indie developer were able to implement that technology is like actually very, very impressive.
Yes.
So on to our next game. So the developer for Telos is who?
Uh-oh, I jumped back a page. That was
Overpowered Games. If you guys are more interested in more, they have a blog on playtelos.com.
And so that brings us to our next game, which I jumped to the bottom of the page. I mean, the
Savage,
top.
The Shard of Gosen,
Planet Tobor, which is robot backwards. We've just got to theme this showcase of robots.
Robots.
We had Robot Studios, and we have Planet Tobor, and then we have the robot game that we just did at Overpowered Studios or Overpowered Games. So, Savage.
Man, is this a mobile game? Wait, hold on.
2D action platforming RPG, and so we're already in the vein of kind of like La Mulana and all of these 2D platforming revivalist games. I think there's a trailer. There we go.
There it is.
Let's hit us, baby.
So, Savage Shard of Gosen.
Yep.
Definitely hearkening to the... I mean, you were definitely excited about the... You were,
yeah.
You guys should have seen Solo, and he was like, oh!
Sega Genesis!
Sega Genesis!
Coming straight off the heels of, obviously, Volgar the Barbarian. Can you flip us to the screenshot? The same design, the same character... that is the same armor from Volgar the Barbarian, which is a new game. That's a contemporary game, still also in the style of Sega Genesis platforming, and also had the same mechanic of... where was it? Probably one of these... There it is.
Yeah, the knife. The knife.
Climbing steps. Up your knives that you throw into the wall. Difference being that you definitely have a number of knives. So I'm wondering how all that resource management works. It seems very, very interesting. There's a lot of different stuff going on that's very different from the... it only takes from the styles of Volgar the Barbarian. The themes and everything else that's going on in the game are completely different. Volgar sets itself as a hardcore platformer in that you are supposed to die often. When you die, you go back to the very beginning of the game and... Stuff like that. This
has
is
like
more.
This has like a story, an open world adventure mode.
A super macho story.
A super macho story.
You're like this Adonis who dances when he walks.
Yeah,
the animation looks amazing.
How you're like hulked over at the same time. And you've got your flowing hair that, you know, reels back when you punch through brick walls.
Yep. You were just straight Fabio.
Yeah.
Dark haired Fabio in a loincloth.
The world map was a nice touch, I think.
Uh-huh.
You know, just the fact that it's also, like, interactable enemies on here. It's definitely pitched as an older style game. And it works really well.
I also wanted to point out the your intense dialogue options.
Yes.
Either say nothing or spit. And that was in the trailer as their indication that there are choices to make in the dialogue.
No, because they demonstrated get savage or die.
Yeah.
There's literally no other option except to become this mighty Gosen warrior.
Yeah, I just loved that. They advertise it like there's many choices, but it's like you have super macho choices and that's it. And I'm like, you know what? All right. Okay, I can dig it. That's the way I want to role play this game anyway. is I don't need the option to like talk my way out of this specific situation.
When I could just rip the shackles off and then flex my bicep to bust through the wall.
You go, Gosen. You go. You get those shards.
All right, so Planet Tobor brings a savage shard of Gosen. You can find more information on their page, folks.
Ooh. Hmm? Something's making a noise.
I think it's the webpage. The webpage is background music.
That's my remix.
All right. Oh, there's an HTML game.
Yeah, this game's actually ready to play right now. And this is The World of the Children, made by James Earl Cox. This is on Game Jolt. And if you've never been to Game Jolt, it's a beautiful, beautiful place where amazing games are made. And I just want to show off the video that they have, if I can.
Let's go to YouTube, because that will change the audio source.
Good call.
I hope.
That's based on Ray Bradbury's The Veldt.
Okay.
Ooh.
So what were your first impressions, Solon?
Well, this is James Earl Cox III, and so he does a lot of very emotional
mm-hmm.
kinds of flash games. He loves to stick to that kind of very succinct pixel art aesthetic, and if you haven't played any James Earl Cox III games, I highly recommend them, because they are always zany and silly
mm-hmm.
and kind of messed up, a little bit unhinged.
It did look a little interesting how like the character like released themselves from reality
mm-hmm.
to like delve into this fantastical like paradiso world where
yep.
everyone's like an
yep.
angel and you know have the heavenly pillars upon the floating islands.
It was bringing together themes of religion and themes of
like ascension and
yeah,
like,
yeah, yeah.
Or like
those
like
philosophical ideas
uh-huh.
And postmodernist like ideas of the body and the self as digital beings,
and,
but then also heaven as being like this kind of place where you go get wings.
It left me as an observer with the question: is like, is this a fabricated sense of ascension? Like, because
right?
it was like they called it like a digital home or something.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, is this a VR simulation that's
yeah.
like meant to provide us with the satisfaction our soul can't normally attain or something? Like, it was.
But then they have all the religious
yeah,
imagery,
yeah.
halos and the wings.
So
and you are just this like diva, awesome person with the wings and the boots. Just the character
yeah,
looks
like
way
boots.
Too cool for what like 30 pixels total. I'm just like, this character's not supposed to be this cool. It's just like a handheld full of pixels and like.
So there's definitely a lot of
art.
Themes that
mm-hmm.
are put into the game, even though like the gameplay itself is so simplistic.
Yeah.
It already left me thinking about so much in terms
all
of.
All you're doing is moving in spaces,
yep.
and you get a little bit of text also that informs what's going on in the spaces. And so between those, just with those simple bits, they're evoking so many big ideas in by moving through the spaces. Not just like being in one space, you're like, wow, this makes me think. It's by you going from one space to another and traveling and having this kind of adventure. It's just way cool. And obviously it's making us just go, just by the trailer, we haven't played the game yet. And the game is on Game Jolt.
Yeah,
you can play it right now.
It is very much playable. So if you're interested at all, I mean, you could just even be playing it while listening to us blather about it.
Yep.
So, yeah, feel free to check it out.
That's, what was it called again? Oh, no.
And Escape. Backspace.
There it is. The World the Children Made. That's the name of the game.
And we're on to the next title.
All right. This is called Belladonna by Nicholas. Is classic.
Definitely a super mysterious horror adventure game by Nicholas.
Yes.
I love how it explores the concepts of like morality and the persistence of humanity after death.
Mm-hmm.
And like it also, I'm sure it has lots of concepts of over like the dictation of soul and all that.
We have it's another just like the last game, mm-hmm. a very post-humanist game.
Yeah.
But going straight off of the long and wonderful lineage
of Frankenstein.
Frankenstein, Patchwork Girl, even the animated shows, the animated movies that are like Frank and Weenie and all of the, what's his name? The director that does all those black and white, Tim Burton.
Tim Burton.
Tim Burton. And the Tim Burton alikes that people always accredit to Tim Burton when it's not actually him. Coraline. That's what I was thinking first.
There you go. It's definitely pitched as like a mystery adventure. Like mm-hmm. you're seeking to find the answers, but I'm interested by the fact that you're not only looking for answers to like what happened to you, but you're also looking for the answers to the questions that humanity overall seeks.
Mm-hmm.
Like, is there an existence or is there like a purpose after death?
Is there anyone else here?
Yeah. Even then,
it looks
you
like
don't
from the trailer, the way it's framed, it looks like you actually just woke up on the operating table
mm-hmm. and it's empty.
And there's no one there.
And you're like, ooh. Wondering, like,
oh,
where is
it? That's incredibly creepy. I will note, too, that...
thanks,
God. Just like my popping in. No, that Belladonna is the name of the deadly nightshade variety of plant species.
Oh, right. It's the extremely toxic poison that they always use in the romantic novels.
Like a...
Because, you know, they always like drink the tincture of nightshade. And it's
that's
the Belladonna
right.
nightshade. It's like, ah.
You guys are good at this.
Okay, so
that's Nicholas's Belladonna, and so impressive. The great
the key.
First look.
The key.
Yeah,
the key in the back of the head. It makes me wonder what happens, you know, when she turns it, or what happens if she has to pull it out to open the lost door. Ooh.
Yes. Yes.
Okay,
all
so
of this, yes.
Thank you, Nicholas, for submitting that. Definitely looks really cool. So we're on to Lockdown Patrol by Fractile Games.
Mm-hmm. Is it work in progress? Ooh. Love getting works in progress with a free demo, and it looks like the full 40%
version off the full version.
It's only £3. It's only £3. So let's see if we can get some screenshots, videos. There we go. All right. So Fractile Games' Lockdown Protocol.
Automatic lockdown in effect. Red key card required.
Was disgusting.
Definitely extremely gruesome.
Yeah.
Insane. It did look like it was multiplayer.
That's what I saw.
We saw like the enters match and the player deaths and stuff were notated on the top left.
Which might this is something that's an alpha and definitely being worked on.
Oh, there's a built-in level editor?
Yep. That's something we've seen a lot.
So user generated maps. Nice.
Jeez, like John McClane in there, with his just t-shirt and jeans. He's like, a compound of people that probably want to kill me on sight. What are y'all doing here? Pew, 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 pew. The crouch looked so like masculine. He's like, I am a police chief. I'm going to get you from behind this box. Purr, purr, purr.
So I really liked the 2.5D perspective rendering, like how the camera worked.
Yeah.
Like specifically, you saw when he was looking down from like the really, really high platform and like he was looking really far down to the bottom left of the map, the whole camera shifted and gave you some aspect of that perspective.
Yes.
I felt like the camera control work was, you know, even though it's automated, it's really well done.
And it was best probably shown off when they were showing off the score.
Yeah. Because, I mean, you like look around and all the HUD elements and all the UI elements are like projected on top.
Yep.
Like when he was interacting with the elevator, you had that like overlay UI. That was really cool. It was really well done.
And just a big variety of weapons and...
You get the rocket launcher, the taser gun, you got your Raiden X style like beam
just
gun
lightning everywhere.
From enemy to enemy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's called the Zapper. The Zapper.
All right, I want to give us one more game for this round.
One more game.
And this is a very special game. Because this is I'm gonna show off if you would, James. Thank you, God. Gaming Pixels, Gaming Pixies, She Who Fights Monsters. And this is something that we don't have a trailer for. We have a bunch of screenshots and it's already ready to be downloaded. But this is a straight up, this is an RPG Maker style game. It's made in RPG Maker. And it's a survival horror game where you use JRPG conventions inspired by Yume Nikki and Silent Hill, and if those are things that like get you to like, which it does for me, I friggin' love that game. It's a short, quick, to the point, a horror game about being the child of an alcoholic. So we're going into some dark themes and some serious things.
Be warned, everybody. So this is serious.
This is serious?
Yeah.
No, I from what I've seen, just of like the description and this idea and
collecting and unlocking memories and determining who she becomes.
Yes, yes.
Ah.
And so from these screenshots especially, there's a lot of care put into all of the pixel art and all of the assets that they've used for from RPG Maker that are really, really cool.
Wow. Oh, that's so Yume Nikki.
Yep.
That's really cool. You literally traverse her memories
is one of
in
Jenny's
how
world.
She perceived them.
Oh.
The fact that they put indifference there means a lot. Because normally things are so black and white, but because you're dealing literally with the aspect of her persona, there's that gray area.
So this is available for download right now. You can go play this. This is the last game, and this is by Rochelle B. of Gaming Pixie. So big love to her for submitting. And for all of the people who have submitted so far, you guys have really, really put together an amazing showcase of games for Indie E3. And we could not do this without you. To update people, just before we go out, I want to update people on the situation for getting games out there. We are currently in the struggle of finding the, getting access to the old email after our leader had dropped. So we are currently in the process of getting access to that so we can get back to actually getting to emails, which has not happened yet, and that is absolutely our fault. On the other hand, we have instead, in the meantime, put together infrastructure that is much more organized and much more available for devs so that we can also access new emails as more submissions come in, which they have been coming in.
Yes, we've gotten so
because you guys have been amazing.
New content.
But the goal for today, for just day four of Indie E3, has been to get through as many games as we can and give them each individual love so that we can prove to you guys that we can actually do this and that this is something that is very, very important to us.
I think we've done a pretty good job so far.
Yeah, right. Under the circumstances, yes. And within everything, we've gone through 30 games today, just in this first half.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to now go on a break, and we're going to have an interview with Arden. And Arden Ripley is the dev for Date or Die. I almost said Skate or Die, which is the pun that it's making off of. But Date or Die. And I'm very excited to talk to them and see what they've got in store for us. Because this is a brand new game that hasn't been released anywhere and has only been talked about in hushed whispers over Twitter. And Arden, by the way, is the person who does Kindness Coins. If you played that, Kindness Coins is a really amazing game. And they are just a really smart developer, and I'm excited to get their perception on things. So that's what we've got. We're going to do that for an hour. Then we've got more trailer showcase. And then after that, for sure, there's a little bit of schedule snafu, because obviously if you look at the schedule, we have the same thing twice on there for 7 p.m. That's what I get for doing that at 3 in the morning. But I'm not sure if that's going to be on Indie 3 or Indie 4 or what we're going to do, but we probably want to show more games on Indie 3 so that we can keep this train going.
Definitely.
Keep the hype train
definitely
rolling.
Definitely put more coal in the Steam engine as we power on.
But then at 8 o'clock, we have Josh Welchel playing, and I'm so excited. I love Josh. He is an amazing artist and music performer, and so I'm so excited to get to see what he creates for Indie E3. I believe it's going to be a selection of not only his own music, but also other people's music that he wants to celebrate. So
I think that wraps up our scheduled conference for this
block.
Block.
Mm-hmm.
We'll
be back at 4 p.m.,
yeah, we'll be back,
which is 10 minutes from now.
Thanks to you folks for tuning in.